we do want to hear from you. The kids love to hear from you. I mean, this is about the vets, but they like to hear from you, especially what it was like perhaps to be on the home front, to be a young woman during the war as well.
Thank you. I look around and I don't see too many, but I see one back there hiding on me. I'm going to tell you, you mind if I sit down here, Jeff?
Oh, you're great. Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my experience in the Navy when I went in out of high school in 1944. That's when I graduated from this school in 1944. And went right into the Navy, and I went to Farragut, Idaho, if you know where that is. It's a little area in the middle of the mountains out in Idaho, and it's a nice place, really. And I'll tell you what, some of the exercises they put us through that you might kind of enjoy hearing about. The first thing was they're going to test you in the water. And that means they push you in with all your clothes on. And you're supposed to take off your pants and make the wing, what do you call it? It's a butterfly thing. You put your body through it and it floats you. And that's what you have to do. Very difficult to do because you're in water trying to get your shoes off and so forth like that. You have to take your shoestrings and get your feet, get your things tied here and down here. And then you got to put your belt around here, and then you got to blow air in it, and that becomes a float for you. Some of the guys didn't make it, but it was fun to do. Second thing,
didn't make it.
Well, they didn't get the job. They couldn't do it. They had a special class for them, I know, in the evening time. Because I know I was there too, because I didn't do it the first time around. Second thing I want to mention to you is they had a big building in the grounds there. And it was a exercise in trying to put fire out in the bottom of our ship. Now, I use the word ship, so don't use the word boat, because that's a no-no for a sailor, for a Navy guy. Anyway, you have this big hose, and you open the door, and you can see the smoke coming, so you have to put one of these smoke masks on, and get on your stomach, and crawl it in, and crawl down the stairs with your hose in your hand, and get the fire out. And that was kind of a different thing for me to do. But we got through that one. And the last thing I want to mention to you was the scariest one, I think. We had another big building that they put about 50 of us inside. And they had two or three guys in there putting gas masks on us because we never wore them before. And then they turned the gas loose. And now here are some guys that didn't have their mask on, that passed out, and we had to pull them outside to get fresh air. But that wasn't much fun either. But those are the three things I can remember about boot camp. And I'll turn it over to Dean now.
How old were you at the time?
I was 18.
Was that the age for enlistment, or were you drafted?
I was drafted, came out of high school and was drafted. And I chose the Navy because I thought there was a school in Great Lakes, which is only 200 miles from here. And then they sent me to Farragut, Idaho. And then I said, well, I'm going to sign up for radio. There's one of those back in Great Lakes. I went to the Hawaiian Islands for that.
Tough assignment.
Yeah.
I'll come back to you, John.
Thank you.
I was 18 years old. Now I'm 68 years of marriage. I can't add and subtract that quickly. But were you a part of his life at this time?
Well, yeah, pretty much. But we dated in high school, and then broke up after he left High School, I think, for a little while. But we did a lot of letter writing.
She wanted to see the world.
Another year of high school to take care of, so I was doing that while he was serving the country.
No, so let me, were you at all married then later on while he was still in the Navy?
No.
No.
He was out for it.
I'll come back to you, Betty.
Right. Because I went into nurse's training, became a nurse too, in this interim.
Did it all enter your mind that you might be a Navy nurse?
No, it didn't actually. I'm not sure why. I was busy schooling and so that.
Brent, you, I know, are a Marine. And we consider that to be a part of the Navy. And it still is. The Marines are a part of the Department of the Navy. So why did you choose Marines when he chose Navy?
Well, I'll tell you how that happened. And just for a little information for you, back during World War II, when it became imminent that was going to happen, they set up the draft. And you had to register for the draft. Everybody over 18 had to register for the draft. But there were also deferments. And if you were in a critical occupation, they would defer you and be glad to do it, because I was working for a large farmer, and we fed 300 head of cattle a year and 600 hogs and about 9 cows by hand. So we were fully occupied, that was one of the most important things, was keeping food for the troops.
Now, let me just say that, Fred, as long as you're talking about deferments, and those, when you registered for the draft, that was done at the local county level. That is, people living in Linn County would register with the draft board, a locally appointed group of people at the Linn County Courthouse. And same with Johnson County or any of the other counties around here. That was a local decision, and the local draft board ruled on whether or not you were qualified for a deferment, such as involved in the father's farm or something like that.
If you were a skilled machinist or something like that, you were also deferred. Different occupations were vital to the war effort, caused a deferment. And so I was deferred through about half the war, actually. And then I gave up my deferment and volunteered for the draft. And it was about 3-4 months after I did that they called me.
And what year was that?
That was in 1944. I volunteered in October.
And that war at that time was going hot and heavy,
right?
Because Germany was still in it,
right?
And Japan was still,
right,
in it. The war wasn't over until August of 1945.
Right. So I wasn't actually called until January of 45. So I went down to Fort Leonard Woods, down in Missouri, where all the inductees went. And the sergeant there was showing us how to make our bed sack, they called it, in the Marine Corps. And I thought, well, I'm in the Army now. About then a guy came through with a clipboard, and he said, we have room for two Marines today. So I looked over at my friend from Muscatine, and I said, what do you think? He said, let's take it. So we came that close to being in the Army or the Marines.
No, was that a good decision or a bad one?
I'd say it was a good one.
Why?
It led me by a devious route through my service. My last part of my service, I spent up in Great Lakes, Illinois, typing discharges. in World War II, when you were discharged, the government had to pay you 5 cents a mile home from wherever you were discharged. And so the Marine Corps set up a separation center at Great Lakes Naval Training Station and shipped all the Midwest boys in here, and we discharged them from here. For instance, if I'd have been discharged in California where I was, it'd have been 2,000 miles times a nickel. From Great Lakes, Illinois, was only 190, so it was a great economic saving to the government to have the separation center there.
You might have signed my release, you know, Fred?
Yeah, I signed my brother's discharge and went to Fort Sheridan later and picked up my other brother who was discharged from the Army. But while there, if I get a little time, yes. While there, I went down to Chicago one night to the giant USO there. And the summer.
What is the USO?
That's the United Service Organization that furnish calls home. In this case, it was a full service USO that had a dance every night, served sandwiches, played ping pong, and all that type of entertainment. And we still donate to the USO. They send out a few requests for donations, and we still donate to that because. And while I was there, in the outlying suburbs, the girls had what was called GSO organizations, and that stood for Girls Service Organization. And periodically, it was this village's turn to send their girls down to the USO to dance. Area, play ping pong, serve sandwich, and so forth. And while I went down there this one night, and I came out a door from the dance, and she was going in, and I walked through the area and down to another door, and she was coming out. So I said, if we're going to keep meeting like this, would you like to dance? And so we did, and we got along fine.
Was her name Marion?
It was.
Well, so far as the USO is concerned, I don't know if any of you have heard of Bob Hope. You're out of the generation gap. But anyway, he was one of the main entertainers that volunteered for the United Organization. So they went all over the world, no matter where the men were stationed, and they volunteered their services to entertain them. The idea was to have them relax and enjoy themselves for at least a previous time that they were going to be there. And so when they had this USO that we're talking about was downtown in the Loop of Chicago, and they call it the Loop because the elevated makes a circle around the downtown where the main stores are. And they had ping pong. We volunteered, the girls did, to bring sandwiches. So they had sandwiches, they played ping pong, they had a grand piano, they always had a sing-along, and they had what they call a grand march. And I don't know if any of you have participated in the grand march. It was loads of fun. And sometimes you might do that at a graduation ceremony. You get the back of a rectangular room with another couple, and you come down the corner, down the length, across there, and then you meet another couple, and okay. And then all the time that you're marching in this form, you're singing one of the service songs of the military. And we are having a great time, so we keep going around like that and adding two more people, and it's lots of fun.
Well, but what about this young man, this young Marine? Was he in uniform?
He was in uniform, and I think there was maybe one Marine out of about 200 sailors and two Army people. So besides him being individually outstanding, he was outstanding with what his service was. So you do not leave the USO with a service person. That's a no-no. But we did make an appointment with our family because they were dying to meet him. And the next Wednesday, we all got together, and it's been great ever since.
No, they all want to know.
No, he was at Great Lakes, and that's how he happened to be there at that USO, and we were not married until, let's see, what year did we meet? But anyway, we are going to celebrate our 69th anniversary on the 1st of February, so he was a keeper.
During the World War II era, the way of you moved to Idaho, you were transferred to Idaho rather than Great Lakes, which is in the Chicago area, still is. Great Lakes Naval Training Station there, that's where the basic trainees come in yet. But at that time, they moved troops around with troop trains. Did you move by train to Idaho? Or if you didn't, tell us about the troop trains.
I did ride the troop train from Farragut to Fort Ord in California, and that wasn't a fun trip, really. It was crowded, and we were like in, I don't know how many we had in troop ships, and we had a lot of people that went out there, and from there, I went, of course, to the islands, and from there I went over to Tokyo. In fact, I was in the islands there when the Japanese surrendered, and we had quite a party that night.
Tell me about that, gentlemen. You were in the area of the Japanese islands when the peace treaty was signed. General MacArthur and others aboard that ship where the Japanese came on board and signed that historic document that ended the war. Where were you right at the time that was signed?
I was in the Pearl Harbor area. That's where they had me based.
And that's in the Hawaiian Islands.
That's in the Hawaiian Islands, that's right. I caught an LST. If you don't know what an LST is, it's a ship. Not a boat, it's a ship. It's about 60 feet long and maybe 30, 40 feet wide, and has a complement of about 60 people. When you're going along and you hit some rough weather, the back of the ship goes up in the air and just shakes the whole ship. That's the smallest ocean-going vehicle that we had to ride in, and that's what I was riding. I was a radioman. I had to be tied into my chair to take messages because it was so rough, but it wasn't much fun.
Now, where were you riding the, being transported in the LST? You were moving out of Pearl Harbor, which the Japanese had earlier bombed and started World War II. Now you're in that Pearl Harbor area, and you're moving around in that area with an LST. You're not traveling very far in a small ship.
That's correct, except we did go from there over to Guam, and we spent a day there. We didn't go ashore, and then we pulled out of there and went to Okinawa, to Buckner Bay, and that's where we got in trouble with the typhoon. It lasted for about a day and a half, and we were in the end of it, and we were just going up and down, up and down. From there, I went on to Japan, that was quite a sight to see as you pull into that harbor in Sasebo, Japan, and everything in the Japanese area, everything was terraced onto, they used every inch of the area that they could to grow things, but it was all terraced.
Now, you were in the Hawaiian Islands as your basic assignment. You were moving out of the Hawaiian Islands then, and you moved later on into Japan. But Pearl Harbor was still pretty well devastated, I would imagine, when you were assigned there, because even today we can see the remnants of what happened when that was bombed in 1941 on December 7th. Now, what was your accommodation at Pearl Harbor, and what was the reminder that what had happened there when you were assigned there?
Actually, believe it or not, it was pretty well cleaned up. Now, I spent time in the ship repair unit because I had a buddy from Mount Vernon who was in that area. His name was Merrill Pitlick. So what we would do, and I also knew a Marine from our area, we'd call each other and find out who had the best dinner on Sunday, and that's where we'd go. And we actually, while we were there, we were building tennis courts for the officers, and they liked it. So we were busy, but we went from there on, and we didn't, actually, I didn't have any contact with the Japanese. I was just lucky that the war ended when I was in their area.
You were, but did you come in contact with anyone who had? And what is a story that you might be able to relate to us here of when you thought or when you encountered a person who had had a life-changing or really life-endangerment experience?
That brings up a close friend of mine by the name of Herring. He was quite an athlete. He was a graduate from Mount Vernon, same class that I was. In fact, he enlisted rather than being drafted. And he was in all the islands. And he wouldn't talk about it very much, but once in a while, I'll get a story out of him. And he was telling me one night when he was on duty, and he was looking, and the captain came over to him and said, Herring, why don't you take a break and so forth and so on? And he said, well, gosh, I really don't feel like it because I'm not tired. So instead of him taking the watch, he moved out of the way. The captain took his place, and in the next second, he got killed. Boom. He was gone.
By what?
Rifle shot. He got killed that quick.
Betty, in corresponding with someone who was in the Navy at that time, or Army, or Army Air Corps as it was at that time, the Army and the Air Force were connected at that time, just like the Marines and the Navy still are. But what was your means now we can pick up a cell phone and you could reach John just about any place. How did you keep in contact during the war?
Writing letters, the only way, is writing
letters. And that, of course, kept you right up to date because you'd get a card the next day. Is that right, after he wrote it?
No, he was very good about it. I think he wrote every day, didn't you?
We wrote a lot of our correspondence at night when we're on duty. I liked the 11 to 4 shift because I knew the cook downstairs, and at 4 o'clock he always had fresh rolls of donuts for us. I was busy up there writing a letter to Betty. I was all took time out to have a big bake thing. It was very good.
But did you?
I remember phone calls, John. Did we ever?
No, we didn't.
Never did. I'm not sure.
But how long after he wrote a letter, you're out traveling around in the Pacific Ocean, how often did you have mail call?
Well, it wasn't very regular, Dean. I think it was probably maybe 2 weeks between when she wrote the letter and I received it.
Now, Betty, when you received a letter from him, was any, I mean, there was censorship during World War II of correspondence that came back from servicemen and women to their families, and some of it would be heavily redacted, which means some of it was blocked out. Did you ever see anything like that from his letters?
Never.
I'm going to move to you, Fred. You know what I'm talking about in the censorship of letters. Did you, you were not assigned overseas, and so you weren't in a critical area, but you know about the censorship.
Yes.
Can you tell us, tell them about it?
My middle brother was in the Philippine Islands, was wounded there and was in the hospital for 41 days and was able to get back with his unit, and they were the first ones to land on Japan, and he served there in the occupation forces. But some of his letters were censored, things taken out of them. My youngest brother was in the Southern Islands and was coming up to Okinawa when the battle was going to take place. And their unit was off the southern part of the island, and they all loaded into the landing craft that John's talking about and made a feint at the south end of the island and didn't go ashore, went back out to the ship, and the next day, the same thing. But what they had, the strategy was to draw the Japanese forces down to that island, end of the island, think they were going to be attacked from there. And actually another unit came in from the north and helped to secure the island. I don't remember, I'm sure his letters, if he didn't write many, but I'm sure if he did, they were probably had some thing missing from him.
Which means, in order to censor a letter, that letter has to be opened and read by somebody. So I'm sure, Betty, not very many intimate things were put, or John, you would have been the one writing, but you had to be careful what you were writing, not only to divulge your location or something that might be of value if this correspondence fell into enemy hands, but also you didn't want somebody else reading your deepest feelings either, did you?
That's correct. I might tell you this. When I came back from overseas in this LST, and we were parked in this down around outside of San Francisco, and all of a sudden one night we hear all this noise, airplanes going around this island, which was about 2.5 miles from us, which was and is Alcatraz. And they had a big prison break that night, and these airplanes and ships, it was really a wild night trying to find these guys that had got away. But that's it, thank you.
Now you experienced the draft. Just let me ask a question. Was the draft, it was a necessary thing because they had to have man and woman power in the armed forces. Women didn't have to register for the draft. They volunteered if they wanted to enter the WAVES, that's the Women's Navy, WACS, which is the Women's Army, and WAFS is the Women's Air Force.
WAM, or that's the WAMS, isn't it? What is it the women call?
WAVES and WAFS.
What were they?
WAVES.
Yeah, WAVES, that's right. Yeah,
that's the Navy. But get me back to the question here. Are you sorry that there is no longer a draft, that it is a volunteer force, or was that an impediment to your planning a career?
No, it wasn't, because I certainly didn't know what I was going to do, but it was nice that I did go into service, because when we came out, we all got free tuition, plus a stipend that they would send you every month to take care of your living expenses. It was possible by receiving that, I was able to go to Cornell College and graduate, because we had that GI Bill that came through that let many of us go to school.
And Fred, same question on you. You were, you might say, encouraged to enlist because there was a draft, and you were getting a deferment, but you volunteered to do away with that deferment that you had and go in. That tells me that you were of such a patriotic person and bent of mind that you thought that you ought to be serving. What's your feeling on the draft?
Well, I think there's a period in each of these young people's lives coming up where a lot of young people have a trouble finding their way. And 18 months or 2 years of military service would be a very enlightening experience. So that's kind of my thoughts of it.
I thought he should mention what he studied when he was in service and what the division was and what you learned.
Yeah.
As a trainer.
Yeah, I went through Parris Island, South Carolina, which is supposed to be, it's reputed to be one of the worst places in the world, and they're not easy on you down there. Then I went through secondary infantry training at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, and then I had qualified for the combat engineers. And the combat engineers is a 3 month course of everything that you need to know to make a landing and to establish a beachhead and all that type of thing. And we studied everything from water purification, field telephone, heavy equipment, rough carpentry, building bridges, how to blow up bridges, and it was a broad course. And I learned things there that I used later. For instance, when we bought a farm down in West Liberty, it was a low flat farm. And if you dug a ditch with a mechanical bright drag line or backhoe, it left a lit ridge on the side so the water couldn't get through the ditch. So I did a lot of ditching there with dynamite. And at that time I could go over to field lumber company in Tipton, we'd go out to their storage bunker and get two or three cases of dynamite and take them home, and I'd blow these ditches around. And when you did that, the dirt was long gone and the water could get to the ditch. So different things like that I thought were valuable. It's hard to cover all the things we should in a meeting like this, because I want to go back to, I was producing food. But on the home front, everybody had a ration card. You could only buy so much meat, you could only buy so much sugar, you could only buy very scarcely a tire for your car. Gasoline was rationed. You only got like five gallon a week or something like that. And those were all things that were going on in the war, that when you think of war, you don't necessarily think about all the rudimentary things that take place to make the war possible.
I'm going to ask Marion to describe what we had at that time, and that is the ration books. And you had a certain stamp You could tear out some stamps there. That was good for a pair of shoes, but once that stamp was gone, you better make those shoes last. Rubber tires for cars were out of the question. Buying a new car was out of the question. All the automobile plants had turned over to making tanks and other war materials. So tell us, as you grew up in the Chicago area, how did you make do using these ration books that rationed how much sugar, how much clothing and other things that you could buy?
Well, I was really too young to be connected with that. That's more my parents that were doing that. But I remember, because I was still in high school, and when we went any place, we were always sure that we had several people in the car so we wouldn't use so much gas. And they used nylon for the parachutes and other items in military life. So we were short on anything like that, and we used cotton. And the hose that you wore then, you wouldn't want to be seen in today because they weren't too beautiful.
And what she's talking about is H-O-S-E for you young women. That is hose, other than they call them, well, they used to call them nylons, but nylons weren't available, so they wore cotton hose. All the way from your foot to your thigh.
I was going to tell a little bit about a job that I got. I had a job while he was in service, and I worked for a WWZR-FM radio station. Music broadcast all day long, and there was no live talent, so everything was either recorded or transcribed. And because it was wartime and the radio station needed a lot of electronic equipment, we were on the top of the Marshall Field building on LaSalle Street, which is like Wall Street. And we were under lock and key all the time. When I came to work on the main floor, there was a uniformed man that I would check in with, and he'd give me the pass to go on the elevator up about 19 floors, and then I had to change from that elevator to another elevator, and it would take me up to about, I guess it was 42 stores.
So what was so secure about your place of employment?
It's because they had a room full of electronic equipment to broadcast music. When I got up there, somebody was at the door and opened it for me.
So that no one else could get to that electronic equipment and do any broadcasting.
And I had to type. I had to make a record and tape new records that we had, and I had to clear it with the engineers first so they'd open it and I could use the equipment.
Betty, tell us about, if you recall, or anybody else here, back on the home front, there were blackouts at night where, you remember the blackouts?
I really don't. Out on the farm where we lived.
But I wasn't here when that happened, but I just wanted to mention, you talked about shoes. That brings up a story about my little sister, Mary, which you guys don't know. But when I came back from the service, I was loaded with money, you know. I got my discharge money, I got probably, I had overseas money coming, all that stuff. So when I got home, I took my brothers and sisters, and there were five of them, out to buy a new pair of shoes. And she never heard. Never forget that. Thank you.
Anybody here, do you remember, and can you speak to the blackouts? Do you know what I'm talking about? Betty, you said you lived on a farm, but that it affected the entire nation, where, or sections of the nation, where at a certain signal at night, all the lights would be turned out. Now, at that time, some of the rural areas did not have electricity, so it didn't matter anyway. Yeah. Do you remember what I'm talking about now?
I know what you're talking about, and we did not have electricity at that time, so it wouldn't have affected us.
But in the cities, all the lights went out, And that was practiced, just like you hear the sirens here on a certain day in Mount Vernon, it's the sirens. Well, that was practiced for if there were an air attack on the United States, then everybody would know what to do. That is, do not let the enemy guide their aircraft by lights. Everybody, it would be a blackout. I'm going to pause right now because I hope that we've discussed enough here and brought up enough topics that has piqued your curiosity. So anybody have a question, just raise your hand. And then maybe you want to go to a microphone or come up here, please.
Why don't you guys walk up to the microphone?
Do you guys still have the letters you guys wrote back and forth to each other?
We wrote,
yeah,
we wrote quite regularly.
Back and forth. That's right. I don't know how often we did that, but I know that when I had duty at 11 to 4, and the moon was so bright on the ocean, you could be actually bright. I was up in the crow's nest and being watching for things, but it was just so light out, it was beautiful, the ocean.
Betty, did you save any of those letters?
No, I didn't. And I do remember, I didn't mention it, John was so bad. I remember my parents were sort of thinking like, what's this all about? Because they were considering the expense of writing and the stationery and everything. And they thought it was a little much.
Well, postage at that time was probably 2 cents or 3 cents, wasn't it?
Probably was, but it was still, but they thought maybe a little much.
Well, 2 cents was like 50 cents now. And
that's right.
Fred?
And on the service men's end, all you had to do was write free up where the stamp went. And that was a great benefit.
I didn't know that.
The I had a fleeting thought there.
There's a young woman right here has a question.
Okay. You guys say you write back and forth to like your family or whatever. Did you guys write to like other service people or other people in the army or military?
Not really. I did correspond with my middle brother a couple times, but he was on the go over in the Philippine Islands and so forth, and so it was. It wasn't a lot. Now, I met several friends while I was in the Marines. We're close friends, and we corresponded for years till they all passed on and left me. And so I had to quit corresponding with them.
I guess so.
So have you guys kept in touch with any other like people you served with throughout the years? Or like any other men that you've served with?
Ask the question again.
Have you written letters between each other or?
Yeah. You keep in touch with your old buddies, John?
Yes, a fellow that was in class with me named Hemingway. And he was so smart that he didn't have to read anything once, he knew it. And he went into the service with, went to Annapolis, or West Point, and he came out an officer, and anyway, he was traveling back and forth in the air. He was involved in a Minuteman missile type thing, and I just talked to him a couple weeks ago. He finally lost his driver's license. He lives out in New Hampshire, and he was quite a guy.
Yes. Thanks for coming up.
You said you were both, well, technically in the Army and the Navy, you were in the Marines, but what was the ships that you were sailing on?
The ship?
Yes.
The names?
Yeah.
The names of the ships.
Mine was LST 1109. I don't remember, forget it. I spent about over a year on that ship, out floating around but never gotten any action or any problem, but it you got to be close to 60 guys, whether that's all there is, and sometimes you don't get along with them. And I remember one night I got in trouble with one of the
bigger guys. I don't know how it happened, but the next thing I knew, I was on the deck where we store our equipment, and he had me down there, and it didn't take long to get rid of me. He was a guy from out east somewhere. I can't remember where, but he hit me a good one, and that was it.
Tell me, John, about that ship, though. Of course, if you're out that long time, you've got provisions on board, you've got cooks, you have a galley, you have a place to eat, you have a place to sleep. But what was it like? That is very, very compact, I would guess. Not like a submarine, but just about.
Yeah, it was close and it was compact. You slept down below and you had one, two, three tiers up, and there's about 60 of us on the ship. But yeah, you got to know everybody pretty well. The ship itself was just a rough riding ship. I mean, because it was only so big in the ocean, it gets pretty rough. And we were in enough rough weather that I was tied into my radio shack more than once to try to take a message, because the ship was going up and down and I was sliding along with it. So it was a good ship, but we mainly moved mail from one island to the other when we were out doing that. And I know one time when we got to Japan, we were in the area there, and I was talking to one of the officers, and he said, "Do you know now we can keep going the same we're going east, or you can come back west?" And with about the equal distance between here and Mount Vernon. I didn't think I'd ever see Mount Vernon again.
Fred, he asked, the question was, were you ever on ship as a Marine?
The only craft I ever was on was an LCVP, Landing Craft Vehicle Personnel, and it's the stubby little jobs that when you've seen them in war movies and so forth, where they go up to the beach, drop the big gate in front, and you go out through over the front ramp and gently step on a hole. but they had a big mock up there on the inland waterway down in Carolina, and you went on this mock-up, came over the edge, pulled back and everything, and climbed down the rope netting, which is no small feat.
It's about 40, 50 pounds
on. And you get in these landing craft, you go out to sea, and bounce around out there for an hour or so until all my healthy guys get seasick. And then you head in the shore and drop the gear, jump out.
What was the most difficult part of your time in the Marines? You said that it wasn't exactly a fun time at Paris Island, and I can understand that, but what was the most difficult time for you when you thought, what have I gotten myself into?
I would say that boot camp was trying, but I will also say that when I went to the Marines, from all this physical labor of feeding all these cattle and going on, but that was probably the most trying.
Let me ask Betty, you remember the Victory Gardens. Do you remember Victory Gardens? No. You do?
I didn't have a Victory Garden, but it was wonderful. And it kind of reminded me of what we try to do today to raise people, volunteer to have gardens to raise healthful food, because a lot of people can't pay for lettuce and various fresh vegetables, and I think it's a good project. But I wanted to mention, too, that every place we've traveled, and we've traveled quite a bit.
Will Dragon to the office, please. Will Dragon.
We would go to every boat we could find. We've been on so many boats. What really impressed me was being on a submarine with a tall fellow that actually had driven and operated a submarine. And he talked about the hundreds and hundreds of calories. They feed them the best steaks. They just load them with food because they perspire so much. They're losing weight all the time. And it's really a competition of trying to be physically fit to operate in a submarine.
He still said that he'd lose 60 pounds in a 6-month deployment, you know, because you're just in there and you eat all this good food, but you're also perspiring and exhaling it and so forth.
Is there anyone, did I get any takers on, you remember the war effort and what people were doing back stateside and the Victory Gardens? You don't remember that, John. Victory Gardens were a part of the war effort, just like the rationing stamps. Victory Gardens were an encouragement by the government for people to produce their own food back home. And so that, it was just an all-out time of very austere living in the United States at that point, and with a lot of doing without. In fact, when you were talking about rubber tires, for example, rubber tires were not available, I remember, as a little boy at that time. In fact, people, in order to move sometimes, they exhausted their rubber stamps for tires, and that was synthetic rubber. It wasn't really rubber, it was synthetic rubber, and people would, even to the point of driving on the rims of the cars because you could not buy tires. Victory Gardens were an encouragement of people to also produce their own food. Fred?
I came from farm background, and of course we always have big gardens, and the thing that you have to remember is that during that time at least 50% of the farms in the country had no electricity, and so there was no way to freeze it or anything like that, so you had to can everything that you wanted to preserve except meat, and you put that in a 55-gallon wooden barrel, put in a layer of pork covered with salt, put in another layer of pork covered with salt, and during the winter then you reached down there with a hook, hooked on, pulled up a piece of meat and washed it with water and vinegar, and a good evening.
And while you're coming up with your question, I remember that as a person in grade school at that elementary school at that time, we were sent out across the countryside to go across in pastures and things like that and pick milkweed pods and put them into bags, which then were sent for the war effort, and they were used in life jackets.
What was it like coming home after serving?
What was it like to come home after serving?
Well, it was great. I came into back into Minneapolis. That's where I was discharged, and wouldn't you know it, I get in my train to come from Minneapolis down to Cedar Rapids, and here next to me was an old friend, Paul Scott. Now, Dean remembers him, so we rode back together. He was, I don't know what he was doing up there, but he was a great guy and quite a storyteller, and he only lived to be 95 or 6, but he was really a great guy.
Real quick, was it hard to adjust from military life to civilian life?
It didn't take very long for me.
There's a building up on Main Street that belongs to Cornell that's the Paul Scott Admission Home, and it's beautiful. They redid it a few years ago and did an excellent job. They did one big building with all kinds of records and all kinds of important papers, and it's all in one building now, and they had to tear down some old ones that weren't any good anymore, and it's a picture. It's beige with trim, and I think it's a beautiful building.
Okay. We're running out of time, and the last question was, what was it like coming back after discharge?
Well, I'm a fairly adjustable poem. And things didn't go fast right away because the farms were already rented by people who'd gotten out earlier due to a longer amount of service. And jobs were not that plentiful. And but I was able to secure a job in sales work and was successful at that job. And it was a learning experience.
I was just thinking that there's somebody drawing a picture, you forget.
Can we see it?
Sure.
She's been drawing a picture, so I just had to pass you. Oh, great for you. What's your name?
I just have one more fast story to tell. Your favorite daughter. These two. Your favorite daughter. Anyway, when his middle brother came home, he had been injured, so he came home kind of unexpectedly. And as he said, he picked him up and brought him home from Chicago, right? But when he went by West Liberty, he knew that his folks wouldn't know he was coming home. So he put a note in a bottle, and when the train went by West Liberty, he threw it out the window. And someone got a message to his parents that he was coming home. That's just unreal to me.
Great story, great story. Maggie?
Provide an opportunity when we exit to greet our veterans or to thank our veterans and their spouses for their time and of course our veterans for their service. And then when you leave, the expectation is you grab your stuff and head on to your 7th hour class. My students can wait until last. So let's give them one more round of applause and candy.